All right, guys. So thanks for submitting the polls. So I'll just announce the results. So 88% of today's audience is mechanical engineering, which is great. And 91% of today's audience are basically beginners. So that's around 130, 140 students. And I see that there are 2 to 3 people who have filled out that they are actually advanced ML and AI users. So I would like to point out that this is going to be an introductory level webinar. So guys who are fairly advanced, you might still be able to learn a thing or two from this webinar, but this webinar is primarily oriented or intended for people who have no prior experience with ML and AI. However, this is a series of webinars, so we will have sessions where we discuss intermediary and advanced topics. Okay, so I think the time is
yeah, sir. The time is 6:01. You can I probably think you can start the workshop now.
Great, thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
All right, guys, like I said, once again, thank you all for taking the time out of your busy Saturday evenings to attend this session. We really appreciate it. So before we get started, I just wanted to, you know, take a couple of questions that we all commonly get and answer it. So how long is the session going to be? Well, it depends. There is a demo that has been planned, so it's going to take anywhere between 40 minutes and 1 hour. This webinar is also being recorded, so there is no reason for you to record this webinar, and the recording will be shared on our YouTube channel for free in the next 1 to 2 days. All right, so it would be really great if we don't get the exact same questions again in the chat window. As you can all see, there are 200 plus participants. It's going to be very hard for me to read the chat instantaneously while also presenting. However, I will try my level best to answer questions on the fly. If not, I can try to do a small Q&A at the end of the webinar to answer most of the questions. So that being said, this is an introductory webinar. Majority of today's audience is mechanical engineering students. So we will primarily answer the fundamental question, what is machine learning and artificial intelligence? And I will try my best to not give you another textbook answer. By the end of today's session, you will have a decent understanding of what machine learning and artificial intelligence is. And I will hopefully be able to give you some intuition on how ML and AI can be used, say, in your field of study. If you're a student interested in thermal engineering, or if you're a student who is interested in fluid mechanics, manufacturing, hopefully by the end of today's session, you will have at least one or two ideas on how you can actually use machine learning techniques in those type of applications or projects. So an important thing is to kind of understand the historical background of ML and AI. I think it's very important. This is something that especially the guys with intermediary level expertise will appreciate. So then we'll directly talk about the fundamentals of the subject. So here, the main thing that, you need to get used to is terminology, right? And a lot of fundamental mathematical concepts. So I'm not going to be defining all the concepts that you need to kind of understand that, understand ML and AI completely. That is basically what we teach in our course. But I'm going to kind of give you a generic introduction or a generic intuition, which will help you understand the uses of these math concepts. So then we will obviously look at a cool examples of ML and AI. And I've actually planned a demo on MATLAB where I'm thinking of showing a live example of an image classifier that I've written based upon AlexNet. All right, so let's start with ML and AI. Intelligence and for machine learning, there's no clarity and record that front. So in general, artificial intelligence or in general, machine learning is actually a set or is actually a subset of artificial intelligence. See, artificial intelligence is basically using your computers to do intelligent tasks, tasks that typically only a human being could do. Example, you know, playing chess or driving a car, right? So that is what you would call as artificial intelligence. Machine learning, it is a subset of artificial intelligence. So in machine learning, the idea is very simple. You are training a computer, right? You're training a computer to solve problems, and then you will test the computer to see if it has actually trained properly. A great analogy is you going to an engineering college. So majority of the main reason why all of you enrolled in an engineering college is fairly simple, right? It's to learn engineering, correct? And if you look at the college, what does it do? It trains you and then it tests you. The only bad thing is in most engineering college, the test is an exam, which is not a, you know, bulletproof test, or it's not a aggressive test to test someone's knowledge in engineering. You're just testing the capacity of a person to mug up or memorize details, right? That doesn't work. But that is exactly what machine learning is. In machine learning, you actually have to train your computer to understand a particular problem and then see if it actually solves very well. Just like a poor engineering college, if you train your machine learning model very badly, it's going to give you garbage results, right? So always remember the thing, garbage in, garbage out. If you feed in garbage input to your machine learning model or even to your brain, for example, it's going to be garbage out at the end of the day, correct? So that is kind of the differentiation between machine learning and artificial intelligence. So when people are talking about data science, people are talking about artificial neural network, convolutional neural network, they are in general 90-95% of the time talking about machine learning. Okay, so that is something that you need to understand. Artificial intelligence, like I said, is the larger set. Machine learning is the subset that people care about these days. Okay, now let's think about how do machines learn. There's a typo there, it should be machines, but it's very simple. Most of you have taken some form of engineering mathematics course, I assume, correct? You can just type in yes in the comment section if you have taken any mathematical course. Okay, thank you, Arth. Thank you, Gautam. Great. So if you consider a mathematical course, there is always the concept of functions. Or for example, when we say y is equal to f of x, x is basically called as the inputs to the function and y is called as the output, correct? Now, let me ask some very simple, dumb questions. How many inputs can a function have? Is there a limit to the number of inputs that a function can have? Right? In general, no, correct? There are no limits to the number of inputs. What about output? Can a function have multiple outputs? The answer would again be yes, right? So you can have multiple inputs and multiple outputs. In fact, that is a very nice way to think about a function, because it helps you understand that, okay, it can give you multiple inputs and multiple outputs. Now, mathematically, when you have taken M1, M2 or M3, you're usually given the function. For example, if I say that the function is y is equal to x square, that's the equation of a parabola, right? So now if x is equal to 2, what is y equal to? Exactly, right? Fairly simple. I've given you the function, and now with this function, you're able to calculate the output provided I give you an input. Now machine learning, it just works the opposite way. I will give you an input and output. Now you need to figure out what the function is. So let's just go through a simple example. I'll say that y is equal to 27 and x is equal to 3. Can anyone figure out what the function is? Y is 27 and x is 3. Exactly, right? Now, what would you do if I also say that, you know, y is equal to 25 and x is equal to 4? Right? You can still calculate, right? You can still calculate it. But here's the thing. What if I tell you that both the inputs and outputs that I gave you are valid? Meaning, when x is equal to 3, y is 27. When x is equal to 4 or whatever I said, I forgot, y is equal to 25, right? when I basically give you both these two inputs and both these outputs. In other words, I give you a set of inputs or a set of outputs, then figuring out F becomes a bit more of a challenge, correct? And that is what machine learning deals with. So usually the number of inputs that you have, you're not giving one or two inputs. If you're just giving one or two inputs, you really don't need machine learning. You can just do curve fits and get away with it. You're dealing with say 10 or 20 inputs. And with respect to outputs, you're looking at, again, this is where things can get a bit tricky, but you can have 1,000 outputs, right? So this is where the concept of matrices come in. Especially in the world of machine learning, you basically provide an input vector, or which could be a row matrix or a column matrix, and also an output vector, right? And then your machine learning model has to compute the function F, which will basically give you this Y output for a given X input. Now, let me ask you this question. Do you think it's going to be very accurate? No, right? But you know, when we're talking about engineering, I cannot say that I cannot go and perform engineering calculations by measuring accuracies using English words. If I say that accuracy is less and accuracy is more, that is relative, correct? So mathematically, you have to figure out a way to represent your accuracy in terms of a number. And this is what you call as a cost function, right? This is a very important terminology that you learn when you jump into machine learning, right? So cost function, so far what have we discussed? We have discussed that X and Y are inputs. These inputs are usually matrices, because you don't have a single input, you have lots of inputs. It can be a row array, row matrix or a column matrix. And then we know that there is something called as a cost function, right? We have something called as cost function, which helps you understand how your predictions are with respect to the provided data. Okay, so then there is this concept of artificial neurons, right? So whenever you hear the term machine learning, you basically hear the term artificial neural network that goes along with it. So what are these artificial neurons? Well, to start with, artificial neurons are basically inspired from a real neuron. A biological neuron is something that everyone has. We have billions of neurons in our brain. So what does the neuron do? Well, I don't want to make this into a biology class, and also I don't know a lot about biological neurons. So to keep it simple, on the left-hand side, you have your dendrites, which is basically an input. Your neurons take inputs, and then on the right-hand side, where you have your axon terminals, that's where the output actually comes, right? So your single neuron is basically like a mathematical function, y is equal to f of x. X is the input that comes through the dendrites, and your neuron does something, right? It does some calculations, and then it produces a y on the right-hand side, right? So this is essentially a y equal to f of x unit. With respect to that function F, a biological neuron obviously performs a lot more calculations than an artificial neuron. Now, if you take this inspiration and try to draw a neuron, which I've done here, this is what you call as an artificial neuron. Traditionally, or you know, if you look at any textbooks, it's not presented this way. The input lines are basically lines; they're straight lines. So I've just modeled them as curves here, so that you know, I can kind of show that, okay, this is very similar to the image that we saw before. But here I have two inputs and I have two outputs, okay? So I'm going to introduce some very small notations. I1 is your first input, okay? I1 is 5, and I2 is your second input, which is equal to 2. And this right here, you can see that this input line is thinner than this input line, right? I'm kind of using this visual representation to explain to you guys the importance of those two inputs, right? So here I have two inputs, 5 and 2, right? What those inputs are, you know, it could be anything, right? Let's not worry about it. The first input, we are giving it a very small weightage. We are saying that W1, the weightage for it is just 1. And the second input, I2, the weightage for it is 12. In other words, I2 will get multiplied 12 times, whereas I1 is getting multiplied only 5 times. And I have two outputs here. The first output is basically summation of products of inputs and weights. And the second output, which should be O2, sorry, not O1, it's nothing but the subtraction of the products of input and weight products. Okay. So now, what's going to be O1 and O2? Can anyone do the calculation very simply? What is O1 and what is O2? And if you're confused, this is O1 and this is O2. Okay, O1 is 29. All right. What about O2? Exactly, right? So O1 is 29 and O2 is minus 19. And this right here, this formula that we have, that we use to compute your outputs is called as your activation functions, right? This activation function is something that I'm saying, right? I'm saying that is what this neuron does. And if you did the math correctly, O1 is going to be 29 and O2 is going to be minus 19. Now let me ask a very simple question here, guys. Now, if we go back to a couple of slides back where we talked about the essence of machine learning, the primary concept that a machine learning model tries to capture is the relationship between input and output, correct? So is my output value known or unknown? Can anyone tell me in the comment section? Is my output value known or unknown? My output value is known, great. What about my input value? Right, my input is also known. So in other words, if I have already chosen my activation function, what is the only thing that I can change in my activation function? No, it's not the input, right? Because input is already known. So let's actually go back one slide. Arth, yes, you're right. If you look at this, O1 and O2 are known, I1, I2 are also known. So the only thing that I can actually adjust is nothing but the weights, W1 and W2. And this right here is essentially the story of machine learning. Now, what we have done is we have explained machine learning with a single neuron, and no serious application is out there which uses a single neuron, okay? What does weightage mean? Vignesh, I believe that's your question, right? See, Vignesh, let me give a very simple example, correct? See, when you're looking at an image, okay? Say that you're looking at an image and you want to figure out if, and you're basically writing a program that will tell you what's the dish. For example, if someone is eating a dosa, you can take a picture of the dosa and your computer program will say that, yes, that's a dosa. If it is paneer butter masala, it's going to give you the right answer, correct? Now, what are some of the inputs or features that I can identify here, right? It could be some shapes, correct? It could be some shapes that I try to recognize. And it could also be the color of the image, correct? Now, if you look at the color of the image, right? If you look at the color of the image, while recognizing foods, the color of the image might not be that important when compared to the shape of the food that you're eating, correct? If I say that you're eating something circular, there's a very good chance that you can kind of guess what that food is going to be. But if I tell you the color of it, right, it's not going to be, right? So if I'm using, so in other words, my color input all gets a lower weightage, right? So I can say that my color is not that important, whereas the shape of my food is very, very important, you know, something like that. Now, Nagashiva made an excellent point, correct? Usually, the activation function that needs to be used is not super clear, correct? People try to go with linear or very basic non-linear activation functions because those are easy to guess. But in real life, there is always a question, right? The order in which your activation functions and the selection of the activation functions helps, it's going to totally change your weights and it's going to basically result in a different model. So a good machine learning model that one research group and a different research group creates might not necessarily come up with a new activation function. It could just be the order of operations that they take is completely different. So what do I mean by that? See, for example, this is whatever you have seen so far is just a single neuron. Now, what's the big picture? The big picture is, well, you know what? Take as many neurons as you want, right? So here I have, you kind of have to start seeing it like this, right? So this is input one, and this is your input number two, and you have your output one, O1 and O2, right? What I'm doing is I'm just connecting that back to the input of another neuron. So I'm stacking up a lot of neurons. At the end of the day, I will get my final outputs here, correct? So this is what you call as the input layer, right? Because that's where the input is coming in. And this is your output layers, right? Because that's where your final output is. So what will you call all of these inner layers, right? A great name is inner layer, but usually the term that people use is called as hidden layers, right? And the depth of the neural network is determined by the number of layers you have. In general, it's okay to say that the more number of layers that a neural network has, the more capable it is. It's not going to be 100% true. There is always a question of, hey, I still have lesser number of layers, but my network is more efficient. Always have that argument. But in general, it's very safe to say that when you increase more layers, or when you increase the number of layers that you have, your model, machine learning model, tends to be more accurate. A great way to think about this, an analogy would be screen pixels, right? Whenever you have more pixels, then usually the clarity is better, correct? Can we all agree? Usually the clarity is better, right? But I can immediately give you a counter. What if you're looking at an image that's just white in color? If you're just looking at an image that's white in color, you don't need million pixels. Even if you have 5 pixels, it's going to look white, right? Correct? But when you have neural networks, when you have more layers, the advantage is you can basically be highly sensitive to the inputs, correct? Meaning in the example that I gave before where I talked about food, if I'm just using two features, just the shape of the food and the color of it, I have very limited number of inputs with which I'm processing my information. So that amount of foods that I can identify will decrease. But if I'm able to look at thousand features to determine if something is a food or not, then my model is far more complex. I will be able to try and figure out, you know, more varieties of dishes if my model works out correctly. Now, obviously there are drawbacks, right? Can anyone think of drawbacks of having more layers? Can anyone think of an easy, or can anyone think of a drawback that immediately comes to their mind? More time, more inputs needed. Exactly. I think you guys hit everything correctly. We'll talk about the disadvantages in the next slide, but typically this is of your neural networks is represented. This representation is typically not used, right? Because it's a bit confusing. So you have your input layers, you have your hidden layers, and you can see that the hidden layer can have more number of activation functions than your original input layers. And then you finally have your output layers. Between each and every hidden layer, you can do additional processing. And this is where a lot of linear algebra comes into play. So if you're wondering about the importance of linear algebra, and a very common operation that's used for this is called as convolution. Okay, looks like my audio got cut. Guys, am I audible again? Okay, awesome, thanks. So let me just repeat the last point. Linear algebra is extremely important when it comes to machine learning applications. So especially in the hidden layer, one of the things that you need to do is you need to take the initial input from the input layer, which is in the matrix form, and you'll have to reduce it you will have to represent it in a lower dimensional form, for which a very common matrix operation called as convolution is done. Right? If you do not know what convolution is, I can give a very simple example that most of you have done. How many of you are familiar with Photoshop? Have you guys used Photoshop or seen someone use Photoshop before? I'm assuming the answer is yes, correct? When you use Photoshop, one of the things that people try to do is, hey, they try to touch up their photo, right? If you have blemishes, if your skin has irregularities, you try to correct it, correct? So what do? You take the smooth tool and then you select a radius and then you click on your... That is a convolution. An image is nothing but a matrix, correct? An image is nothing but a matrix. And what you're basically doing is you're using a convolution matrix to multiply the image cells based upon your selection. Remember in Photoshop, when you do the blur filter, you select your filter size, correct? You press this square bracket and then there is a small circle which grows in size, right? That's your filter, also called as a kernel. Based on the kernel size, the convolution is done and the final output is provided. I have a good example for convolution, I think, which will come in one or two slides. Oh, actually, this is a great example of convolution. So on the top left, right, what I have is I have several squares. These squares represent a pixel, okay? Now what I'm doing is I'm selecting, there's 400 pixels here, 20 pixels along the x-axis and 20 pixels along y-axis, okay? So I'm taking a small kernel first, right? The red matrix that I'm taking is the kernel matrix or the filter matrix. And I'm basically taking all of it. I'm basically doing some very simple matrix multiplication. And the result that I'm getting, I'm just storing it in this first cell. Okay, so in just a single cell, I'm computing all that and I'm storing it. Now what I can do is I can move my convolution to the second cell, do it to the second cell, store it here, third goes there, and fourth goes there. This is basically called as dimensionality reduction, right? I've taken information in 20 cross 20 cells, which is 400, and I'm just representing it in 4 pixels, right? So I'm reducing the number of dimensions, and this basically helps in speeding up my entire ML model. So I'll just go back, right? You're basically reducing the size of the blocks like zip file. Yes, but it is not just reduction in size. You're condensing information from different parts. You're trying to minimize information loss. When you use a zip file, there's no information loss, correct? But here, when you are reducing it, you can actually have information loss. That's the fine difference between what you're saying, where you had given an example of a zip file. So what's the criteria to do that? Well, that's a great question, but I won't answer that right now because that's an intermediary level topic, for which we will basically have webinars. So Varun Rao, how is data lost? Well, think about it, right? So think of this image first, right? You have an image here and the image is represented with 400 pixels. At the end of the day, you have your image converted into just a 2x2 pixel, right? Just by looking at this, you cannot figure out what the original image was. Does that make sense, Varun? Awesome. Okay, so now what happens with more layers? Well, there is more unknown weights, but the system is still you can still determine the weights of it, right? Your model occupies more memory. This is a very small disadvantage. It's not a big disadvantage, but it does happen. You use up more RAM. When is this a problem? Well, see, think about it. Your machine learning models are typically developed in softwares like C++, Python, or MATLAB, correct? But if you look at the end goal is not to have this program sitting in your computer. You're going to install this model or burn this model into your electronic control unit or some type of an embedded system, which is going to use this machine learning model. When you're basically embedding or when you're creating that embedded software, that needs to be highly efficient, your model cannot occupy like 10 GB or 20 GB of RAM because your car might not have such a memory, right? So memory is very, very tricky. As learners of machine learning, I don't think you guys have to worry too much about it. But I think that is something you have to keep in mind in case you develop machine learning models in the future. The other thing is it takes more time to train. Now, this is something that I see that a lot of people get confused. So when we say we are training a model, what does it mean? We are trying to figure out those weights, correct? Now, why would it take more time to train? Very simple. At the end of the day, you're solving a huge matrix, correct? The amount of time it takes to solve a matrix depends upon the The voice is not gone. I asked a question. The amount of time it takes to train a matrix or sorry, solve a matrix depends upon the size of the matrix, right? Exactly. Now, the final thing that happens because of more layers is it becomes more accurate. Now, this again, you have to be very careful. If you do not understand the background math of machine learning, just increasing the number of layers might not essentially do anything. In fact, it will just increase the computational cost. You might end up with something called as overfitting or underfitting. Can parallel computations help in such complex time-consuming problems? That's an excellent point, Ram. In fact, if you take the world of machine learning, there is an equal amount of effort being spent in parallelizing the calculations. In fact, any modern company that uses machine learning a lot relies upon graphical processing units, right? So you guys must all have NVIDIA based graphics card, right? Which you use to play games. Although we told our parents that we are basically buying a graphics card to learn CAD. You know, it's never true. We always end up playing games with it. And if you look at your graphical processing unit, it has a lot of tiny cores, right? One of my professors used to give a very nice example. CPUs are really powerful, correct? So CPUs are basically like your bullocks. They're like your buffaloes. They can do a lot of work, but you have only one or two buffaloes, correct? But your GPUs are basically like a farm of chickens, right? You have a lot of chickens, but if you use them correctly, the chickens can actually do a lot of work, right? So that's basically how you have to think about GPU. You have a lot of chickens, which you basically use, you have it in your computer, you're not using it, but you can use it to train your model, right? And with GPUs, your training time reduces a lot. Okay. All right. Okay, what about the complexity of the tasks? That's a great point. Varun, one of the reasons why we outsource this to a GPU is because the tasks are not that complex. They are basic algebra, which can be done in parallel. All right. So now the other thing that I think many of you should understand is why are people so crazy about artificial intelligence and machine learning now, right? The answer is very simple. See, you will soon learn that machine learning and artificial intelligence have been there for a while. In the next slide, we'll kind of prove it to you. But now we are basically we are in a time where computers are really cheap, right? And the machine learning algorithms that we have right now are in a much better shape. And because of this, you have an amazing set of problems that can be solved, right? For example, how can you create the next Facebook? Well, you cannot create the next Facebook by just creating a copy of Facebook, correct? Getting the competitive advantage is very, very hard. It's going to be very, very hard. But now artificial intelligence and machine learning can be the differentiator, right? It is still a new field, correct? It's still a new field, but if you're able to understand it very well, and if you're clever enough to think of a business opportunity that uses ML algorithms to solve a wide range of problems, you can immediately make a breakthrough in the world of business and create a very big company. And people don't want to miss that opportunity. That's why there's a lot of start working on it. And even companies like Google and Facebook are investing a lot of money in that because they don't want to lose to a startup which has, you know, outbeat them by some clever algorithm. How much RAM required to run machine learning? See, this is something that is, you cannot just answer that, right? Answer that without understanding what the problem is. Usually for some of the applications that I'll show today, you know, your RAM, if you have a 16 GB machine maximum, that should be sufficient. Is AI a threat to workers in manufacturing? Depends. Yes, there are some examples, right? And in one of the examples that I show today, you can kind of see how AI can actually replace some of the jobs that, you know, that grassroots level workers are working on. Okay. So, but before that, let's kind of quickly run through the historical background, right? So AI and ML, it's not old at all. Right from 1943, you know, people started working on it. Warren and Walter basically thought about the first artificial neuron in 1943. And then almost every decade, a major development has taken place. I won't bore you with the details, but 2000, right? The year 2000 was kind of the kickstarting point of ML and AI, because 1999 is when the era of GPU started. And then by 1997, majority of the well-known algorithms have been established, so people could actually get really good results. For example, today we will be demonstrating something called as the AlexNet, which is based upon convolutional neural network for image classification. This neural network is, as of today, is much smarter than human beings. Imagine, right? Something in a computer that's smarter than a human being to figure out or to classify images. And I'll give you a live example that's running on my low configuration computer here, right? I'll show that to you. But this is something that you need to keep in mind. ML and AI is definitely not new, right? People have been working on it for 50, 60 years. But it's right now, it's a great time to learn, and it's also a great time to build products using ML and AI. And this was, you know, if you go to Cornell's archives, this was the first perceptron. So if you remember the calculations that I showed you, right? We calculated O1 and O2, right? This thing right here that's being shown on the screen can actually do that. But it's not a single neuron. There are multiple layers of neurons that can be done. How is IoT different from ML and AI? I think they are completely different, right? See, IoT, Internet of Things, is essentially saying that, you know, hey, internet is not only for smartphones and for your computers, it's for everything that you have. Any digital device that you have is going to be connected via the internet. That's essentially the idea of Internet of Things. Now, ML and AI can be used as a layer to make things much more interesting and user-friendly. That's kind of the idea. I hope I answered that question. Does it deal with MPI? That's a great question. So MPI, for those of you who don't know, MPI is basically message passing interface, right? It's a library that helps you perform calculations in parallel. And yes, that is correct. Many people are, you know, there's majority amount of work that was already done to parallelize machine learning calculations. What do I mean by that? Well, if you have a GPU with 100 cores, I can actually use that 100 cores of a GPU to do computation. That's the advantage. Okay. I hope I'm still audible. Omkar, can we use ML and AI in CAE? Yes, absolutely. I actually had an example, but I removed it because I was under the impression that we will have more non-mechanical engineering guys. But I can definitely talk about a mechanical engineering example, especially in the area of CAE. Omkar, if I don't talk about it, you can just remind me. The next thing is terminology, right? Terminology, why are we talking about that? Well, again, I'm assuming that majority of you want to jump into a career with respect to data science, or thinking about jumping into a career, right? When you're going for an interview or when you're thinking about learning machine learning, these are the things that you need to know. Types of data, right? So there's data, which where you have your validation data and also your test data. What do we mean by data here? Well, if I'm creating an application that can recognize the food that you're eating, when I say data, it can mean it would represent the pictures of the various foods that I want to identify. So you will basically go to every hotel out there, take pictures of idli, samosa, pav, whatever it is that you like to eat. And when you take pictures of that, that becomes your data. Now there's validation data and test data. I know that the names are a bit confusing, but essentially you will use some of the images that you have taken to train your machine learning model. And you will use some of the images that you have taken to test your machine learning, right? Again, use the engineering college example here. I will give you 20 images, right? So that you study. And then in the exam, I give you totally different 20 images, correct? That's basically your test data and training data. And then when it comes to machine learning, there are three fundamental classifications: supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforcement learning. Now for mechanical engineering examples, you can think of, at the end of today's webinar, you will be able to think of different problems for which you can have machine learning based solutions, but majority of them would basically use supervised learning. So supervised learning is where you actually tell the computer, hey, this is the correct answer. But you give the correct answer for a given set of entities, and then the computer has to figure out how to predict the right answer for totally unknown data sets. That is called as supervised. Unsupervised learning is again for much more complex problems where you don't know what the right answer is, right? Unsupervised learning essentially tries to figure out what the input is by actually studying the input. So unsupervised learning in a way requires an enormous amount of inputs before it can actually get before it can actually be useful. Reinforcement learning, again, a very favorite, is a great example, and you can actually learn it from real life. I don't think anyone here is old enough to have kids, or some of you might have kids. Reinforcement learning is what you do with your kids. If they do something wrong, you say that they've done a bad job and you make them stand in a bad corner, right? And if they listen to you, if they turn the TV off after you've said, you're going to say that, yes, good job, right? And you pat them on the back. That is called as reinforcement. In other words, whenever there's a positive outcome, you reward it. And whenever there is a negative outcome, you penalize it. That is reinforcement learning. In other words, there is manual intervention, correct? Reinforcement learning is great for creating applications like driverless cars, because whenever there's a right move, you know, whenever you saved a passenger's life, whenever you saved a hit, I think you should be rewarded for it, right? The machine learning model has to be rewarded for it. Supervised learning, money, I'm going to give you an example, right? We are going to actually go through an example for supervised learning at the end of it. Finally, quality of prediction. There are only three options here. The option that I've not included is basically good quality of prediction, meaning if you did a good job of prediction, you know, that's basically, you know, good quality of prediction. The opposites here are overfitting and underfitting. And what do we mean by overfitting? See, overfitting is basically very simple. It is when the machine learning model is trying to predict the outputs for the given set of inputs in a very, very vigorous way, so that it's kind of biased to the input. Meaning, if you give an image which looks exactly like the training data, it's going to recognize. It's going to do a great job. But if the image is slightly different, what do I mean by that? Well, you take a picture of, you know, 10 idlis in top view, right? And now you take and your images are always in top view, correct? Your images are always in top view. Now, suddenly when I test it, I give an image where a person is eating idlis in the side view, correct? The model is suddenly going to get confused and it's going to give you really bad results. So overfitting is highly sensitive. You can say that. I think that's right to say. Should a mechanical engineer watch this lecture? Because I'm not able to understand a thing. Oh, that's highly unfortunate. I hope others are not feeling that way. Guys, if you find the lecture useful till this point, if you can just comment yes, that would be really helpful. Okay, I see a few yeses. That's good. Okay. All right. So now let's come to some really, really interesting applications. Obviously, healthcare industry is one of the things, one of the first industries that started using AI and ML because there's an amazing, unbelievable amount of data, right? So if you look at what you're looking at here is scans where your brain is basically a 3D object, correct? You're looking at slices that have been taken at different heights. So if you take all the slices, you can actually reconstruct the 3D data set. Okay, so here, what's happening is the top row, the first row is basically real life data where brain tumor has been detected with an experienced physician in the site. And the bottom row is basically tumors being detected via GPU computer, right? So this was the work done by NVIDIA. And you can kind of see that it's just unbelievably close, right? So this is great because if we have such a model in place, the healthcare facility will be very cheap and you can actually take it to remote applications or remote places where you don't have trained physicians or you don't have trained technicians at all, right? So I think there was a question regarding how do you reward something more? Well, see, it's very simple, right? At the end of the day, it's a very simple example. See, I have my output and say that the output, the answer that I'm looking for is 45, correct? And my model is predicting that my output is 43, correct? Now, what I can actually do is basically based on this difference, I can actually reward the model a bit more for this set of weights that it already has. In other words, for this particular configuration, it's going to be very hard for the model to say pick a different answer. I hope that makes sense. Okay, so the second thing that I really like, I think this is almost relatively newer paper. It's called adversarial learning. I think I just have to play this and you'll be able to understand what it does. Right, I'll just play it one more time. All right, now let me just explain what's going on here. So this right here is basically what you call as generative machine learning models. So here we basically provide Albert Einstein's picture. And then what we basically do is we record someone speaking. For example, let us say that I have a video camera here. It looks at how I speak a sentence. For example, if I'm saying something like, hey guys, this is Sarang from Skilllink. I can actually use this video clip to create something called as a face landing map. And I can use that landing map and I can put it onto Albert Einstein's face. And actually I can make him say the same statement exactly how I did it, right? So deep fake, yes, exactly, right? So this is basically the basis of deep fake, which looks like some of you already know. I won't call it as motion capturing, but yes, in a way it does it, but it's not that direct. So the next thing I think many mechanical engineers would recognize this is basically you're looking at a power plant or whatever processing it is. What you can do is you can actually use machine learning models to predict failures. For example, this could be any mechanical system, right? You can actually figure out by continuously collecting data, you can figure out the probability of a failure, right? And this is where what I'm saying is, well, yes, this might actually lead to job loss of, say, a in-house expert who typically does that, correct? But it's still going to add more jobs because now your predictive maintenance is going to be done by in schedule, correct? So when there is 76% probability of, say, this system getting failed, you can actually arrange maintenance, schedule the maintenance. And this is where you would basically involve your maintenance engineers. So the only thing that the machine is actually taking away is figuring out where the mechanical failure would occur. And for production lines, this is actually super important because the downtime in any type of production line is going to be really bad for the profit of that particular organization. And there are mission critical applications. Think of nuclear reactors, correct? Nuclear reactors, you know, you have to be even more careful, right? And softwares like SIBO, they give out of the box solution which basically predicts things on the fly. And this is not only used for mechanical companies, right? Think about airlines. So in airlines, you know, it's operationally very, very intensive business, right? You know, we basically, for example, as travelers, if our flight gets delayed like 20 or 30 minutes, if we are taxiing for another 20 minutes, we basically are extremely pissed off, correct? But if you look at the airways, whenever they taxi, they have to pay more to the they essentially pay out of their pocket. So in other words, taxiing is something that they don't enjoy as well. And one of the reasons why this actually happens is, you know, passengers, there is, you know, unknown mechanical failure, which basically led to the delay of one flight, which is now cascading and delaying other flights as well. All of this data is what you call as a sequential data, correct? Whenever you have sequential data, what you should be able to do is, you know, you can use something called as a recurrent neural net, which is just a different structure of neural networks. And that can be combined with something called as long short-term memory modeling to predict these events. So on YouTube, if you basically Google, search for predictive music generation or artwork generation, they're all typically RNN and LSTM based. So what it does is, based on existing moments, it will try to figure out the future, right? So that's why you can actually use it for music generation, any gaming related modeling, right? Where you're looking at past data to figure out future data, you can use RNN plus LSTM. Okay. Sudhir, thank you for putting those definitions. I think people find it very useful. Is Python used for AI and ML? Please answer. Well, the answer is obviously yes. Why cannot we simply put a while if loop program for a threshold value instead of complex AI ML? Well, see, the answer is fairly simple, right? For certain problems, you can actually code the logic, right? But think about the first problem that we started this entire webinar with. I have an image of a dosa, correct? How will you write a program that uses hard-coded rules to figure out if it's a dosa or not, right? That is where I think ML and AI starts to stand out. And yeah, so I was basically talking about applications of machine learning for CAE applications. I think the person that asked that question was Omkar. How many of you are familiar with something called as mid-surface meshing? Mid-surface meshing. Anyone from CAE? Okay, looks like there are one or two guys. So, you know, if you're basically using softwares like Hypermesh, there is something called as a mid-surface meshing or mid-plane meshing. Detecting the mid-surfacing can be done. It is a solved problem, but you can actually predict your mid-surface based upon a machine learning model. So for those of you who do not know what machine learning is, I'll just explain. See, for example, if I have an I-beam like this, correct? If I have an I-beam like this, the mid-surface, the mid-surface for this is going to just be, it's going to just be the, yes, it's going to look like the same shape. The same shape extruded, right? So this, you can basically use machine learning techniques to extract your mid-plane meshing. So when we do mid-surface meshing in 2D shell meshing, there is no need for detailed volume mesh as the thickness of the geometry is not needed. Okay, so I think Sudhir is just typing about mid-surface meshing. So for those of you who are wondering about mid-surface meshing, softwares like ANSA or Hypermesh are used to create this mid-surface meshing. because you create something called as a shell mesh. These are two-dimensional meshes. You do this because this is much more efficient. Your simulations run much more quicker when you do this when compared to three-dimensional meshing. AI will take hypermesh part. I don't think so, but you know, if you're Mayank, if you are deeply using hypermesh or ANSA, right? You know, there are certain things, right? There are certain rules, like your triangles should not be near a circle. There are a lot of rules like that, correct? Those rules can, you can definitely have a machine learning model which can remove those things automatically. ANSA is advanced and it uses Python. Yes, it has a Python interface, but you can actually have an AI model in place so that it can learn what you're doing and try to figure out things accordingly. But developing such a model is not going to be straightforward. Accuracy in the case of mid-surface, yes, it's going to be fairly accurate. It's going to be fairly accurate. Because, you know, if you take things like sheet metal applications, the thickness is fairly uniform. For plastics with variable thickness, your mid-surface also has variable thickness, right? And it typically tends to do a good job. All right, so now let's basically go to the demo of AlexNet. So we are basically coming to the last phase of the webinar. So let me jump to MATLAB here. And what I'm going to do is fairly simple. So I hope Surya or Ashok, can you guys see my screen?
Yes, I can see your screen, Mr. Sarang. But your voice was actually a bit gone, but now it's perfect.
Okay, great. Thank you. So I just repeat what I said. So now we're going to demonstrate a very simple program that I wrote. And what the program does is very simple, right? So on the bottom left, I hope everyone can see this image. So can anyone tell me what is this image? It's a keyboard. Good. What is this image? It's a car, right? So remember those things, right? It's a car. Some people are being very specific. That's great. And finally, what image is this? A beach. Great. Again, remember those answers, okay? See, what I'm doing is I'm basically using AlexNet, which is a pre-built model. So let's explore that. See, if I look at AlexNet, it has 25 layers, correct? So if you remember the examples that I talked about, we had only a few layers. So what I'm going to do is I am going to type in net.layers to look at all the layers, right? So here you can see that the first data is my image input. And you can see that it is asking for images to be in this dimension, 227 pixels along x-axis, 227 pixels along y-axis, and cross 3. Can anyone tell me why it's 227 cross 227 cross 3? Can anyone answer that question? Exactly. It's for RGB, correct? It's for RGB. So you have your red channel, green channel, and blue channel. And each red, green, and blue is a 227 cross 227 matrix. When you join them together, you see your color image. This is exactly how your TV works. For example, today, if you have your TV, just go near the TV and then try to zoom really close. You will actually see these three colors. Every pixel is just a combination of these three colors. So Varun Rao, why 227 cross 227? That's a great question. The answer is fairly simple. Whenever you're doing machine learning or machine learning models, the data is fairly reduced. 227 cross 227 is very, very small, correct? It's very, very small. So the reason why it's actually so small is, you know, it's a trade-off, right? It has to be accurate enough, but at the same time, it should not take too much time to train the model. Why cross three? Well, that's basically three channels, red, green, and blue channels. Okay, so you can see that the first image is, the first layer is basically, the first layer takes in the image. And then you can see that after that, you have your convolutional, network, RELU, right? It's basically a rectifier linear unit. And then you have your pooling unit, convolution, and then the same thing just keeps on repeating. And your final layer, so if I type in layer, and since MATLAB deals with arrays, if I type in layers of 25, it goes to my last layer, which is essentially, it gives me the cross entropy. It gives me the probability distribution function. And what this particular model does is, it at the end of the day, if I show an image, it will give me 1,000 numbers. Okay? The number represents the probability of this image belonging to one of those 1,000 categories. So what is AlexNet? AlexNet is basically a convolutional neural network which can classify images in 1,000 categories. So there are 1,000 categories like, you know, beaches, cars, buses, airplanes, electronics, and so on. So for those 1,000 classifications, AlexNet will give you a number, right? So based on that number, you can figure out if it actually predicts things correctly or not. So the first one, what we can do is, I'm just going to type in file 01.jpg. What you can see that I'm reading this image in MATLAB, and I'm resizing the image to 227x227. And then I'm running it through a classifier. And then I'm basically doing some stuff to plot the data, okay? So let's just run this code. So I'm running this code, and what I'm basically doing is, I'm creating a bar graph, and it basically says that it has 90% plus confidence or probability that this is actually a seashore. Now, how many of you said that it's actually a beach, right? It's not a beach, it's a seashore. So that is why I said that AlexNet is fairly good in classifying images. It's better than a lot of human beings. In fact, it was better than a lot of people who answered that question in the chat box today, right? So now let's take a look at a different example. The second image is a keyboard, right? So what I'm going to do is, I'm just going to come here and modify the image. We'll just let it run. You can see that it does not take a lot of time. And here you can see that it's predicting a few different categories, right? So you can see that 55% roughly, it's saying that it's a computer keyboard, but then for some reason, it's thinking that it's also a handheld computer, correct? So what do you guys think? Do you guys think that this prediction is fairly good? Yes, but it's not that great. Ideally, you want this number to be 90%. All right, let's try our third image. Our third image, I think the most common answer that we got was a car. So let's just look at it. Right, you can see that right off the bat, it just says sports car. Right, it did not have any doubts. So this is actually fairly good. Now, what do you do? Like as a mechanical engineer or as an aerospace engineer, what can I do with, say, this AlexNet? See, AlexNet is basically a trained network. Now, in machine learning, there is an important concept called as transfer learning. So what is transfer learning? See, if a network is able to recognize, say, images in general category, I can use the same network to classify, say, specialized mechanical components. So is there anyone here who basically works for automotive companies, especially automotive plastics? See, especially looks like there's just one or two people. Okay, three people, great. See, especially if you're working in the plastics field or sheet metal field, the parts have unique names, correct? The parts have unique names, and it's very hard for, say, initial engineers to come and learn what those parts are. Correct? So also the material names can be fairly confusing. So what you can actually do is you can use AlexNet and perform something called as transfer learning. So what you can do is you can go today and take pictures of different plastic components in all these cars, correct? Take 20, 30 cars, take pictures, and then you retrain your AlexNet and then you have to label the data set. Again, these are things that we teach in our courses. If you relabel it, then what you can do is, if you throw in an image, it will tell you what the plastic component is, right? And also the earlier example, right? If you basically, you can do the same thing to identify foods. You can go today, especially if you're in Chennai, if you're in any place where street food is really famous, go out there and take a lot of pictures, perform transfer learning with AlexNet, and then you can actually create an app which basically uses this model as a backend, and you can even ship it to an embedded system, right? You can have a small Arduino board with a camera, and you can create a very small pocket size device which can identify plastic components, food, or whatever it is. Okay. Is Google Photo the same as AlexNet? I don't think so. What if it's not able to recognize? What would be the result? Well, that's always a good question. Without trying it, you will never know. Okay. All right, guys. But that being said, I hope you guys found this presentation useful. I'm going to stop sharing my screen right now. And I'm going to be launching a poll. So, guys, looks like Kaushik, I'm unable to launch a poll here. Can you help me out? There should be a poll called as instructor feedback. Are you able to see it?
No, Mr. Sarang, no.
Do you basically see something called as polls?
No.
See in the bottom, right? You have invite, manage participants, share the screen. On the left side of share.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
You don't see it?
Yes, I see that.
Can you launch it, please? Sai Sivaprasad, is there any use of identifying the parts? Well, there is, right? For example, identifying parts is not a single person's job, but say as a mechanical engineer, you want to get trained in plastics. Basically, you're becoming a plastics designer, right? You cannot keep asking your colleagues, what is the name of this part and what is the name of that part, correct? So building such an app can be very useful. You know, it can be useful across your organization. And it's not only that. It can be used for classifying parts with poor quality also, right? However, you have to capture poor quality on camera. That's the most important thing. Jinu George, examples of AI in thermal analysis. AI is used a lot in CFD, but right now in this particular webinar, I don't think I'll have time to go over it. Kaushik, have you launched the poll?
Yes, Mr. Sarang. So actually, I couldn't see any poll. So I did see poll. 1 minute.
Yeah, can you please? And Surya, if you're on the call, I think you're kind of logged in on the same account as me. And that is why I'm unable to launch the poll.